All right. Good evening, everyone. It's been a long day since morning, so we'll come to the topic as was said. It's the penultimate, and then we have the award session after this. We have talked a lot about demand planning throughout the day, also around quantitative. There have been aspects which have already been covered. So I'll try to focus on some things that we did not talk about during the panel discussions and the earlier presentations. I always like to start this conversation around, although all of us come from the demand planning background, so we have this, we know this answer, but just asking ourselves that why cognitive demand planning? Why are we even doing this? So that's one question which I think all of us as practitioners, as consultants, we need to be clear when we get engaged in a particular conversation on why are we embarking on this aspect of cognitive for demand planning. Although the answers tend to be the same, but in that specific context, we need to know what have we done so far. Have we used up all the traditional algorithms, all the traditional approaches? Have we maximized all of that? Or if I'm doing demand planning on Excel sheets, and I say, okay, I want to jump to cognitive, that may not be the right approach. That may not be, it may be too big a jump to take. So typically, we would get into these conversations when you have exhausted the potential that traditional algorithms have, which also include regression models, time series models, and you kind of hit some kind of a glass ceiling. Then you're, okay, I've tried everything, I've done whatever I could. Now I need to do something more. I've kind of reached a max, a plateau that I need to now go beyond. And what everyone's looking for is, I have a lot of this data, a lot of new technologies. Everyone's talking about sensors. People are talking about machine learning, neural networks. Can I build something which can take all this information, all this data, process it, and give me some numbers which are better than what I'm doing today? Also bring along with that some level of automation. If I take, I've also interacted a lot of time with students in this subject. So when in the classroom, what happens is the typical approach is, okay, let's take one SKU location combination and let's try to build an algorithm around it. We can make it work. We can do 10 different things. We can do 20 different things to make it work for one SKU, two SKUs. But can I really scale it up? Can I really do this for the kind of combinations we are talking about? That becomes an important aspect. So it's not just using this external data, using new algorithms, but can I bring along a level of automation so that this can really scale up to the kind of business problem, a real life problem that we're trying to solve, and learn over a period of time. We as human beings, we have grown. The way when we say somebody is growing up, that means we are learning new things. We are learning, we are absorbing the essence out of that and applying that the next time we are faced with the same situation. So can my algorithm, can this machine now start mimicking the way I have grown up? Can the algorithm, can the solution itself grow, right, as time progresses? So these are kind of things people are looking for. So what has really changed? When I was doing my engineering here itself in Hawaii, we had courses on neural networks. We had courses on artificial intelligence. Even 20, 25 years back, we used to study that. So what has really changed? What has changed is three dimensions I will talk about. One is data availability. At that time, if I had to really test something, I did not have the data. Right? I knew the algorithm, but I did not have data. I did not have data in a structured format that I could feed into a system which can really help me validate that algorithm. I did not have training data sets. That's a big thing. How do I even make that algorithm learn? Where do I get so much of real life data? That was not possible. So that is one thing which has changed. The computing power. In those days, getting access to an email used to be a big thing. Yeah, today we have mobile phones which are much, much more powerful than laptops that we used to have. Computing power definitely has evolved. A lot of high computing power that is very, very easily accessible even to a student. Like, now forget about corporations. Even as an individual, if I want to do something, I have easy access to computing power. So I have access to data, I have access to computing power, as well as all these new technologies which have emerged, new sensors, the whole sensor-based technology, or the social network based data. I can build interfaces, I can build apps which can quickly pull out information from different internet sources that we have. So these are kind of things which have changed, which has again brought these algorithms to the forefront. Right? It's not that these ideas were not there 10 years back, 20 years back. People never thought about neural networks. I mean, it's been a field which has been around, but these are some of the advancements that have brought everything back into the forefront, saying that, yes, can I now leverage all this to further improve my accuracies, further improve my demand planning processes? Right? In terms of algorithms, we've gone through this throughout the day. We have these self-learning algorithms that we talked about, that how do we make algorithms learn the way we learn? We want our children to learn the same way. It's like something which is there, right, on the laptop. We want, yeah, you learn this. Yes, so that it can learn over a period of time and start performing better and better when it's faced with the same situation. Automated complex decision making, some panelists did speak about earlier on some things which are not visible to the human eye. Yeah, many a times, and it could just be, as I said, if there are only 10 things, 10 SKUs to look at, maybe you will go into, like what you're saying, in the Balkit Hal Udherna. You go to that level of detail, but if you had to do that with 100,000 combinations, you will not be able to do. So how do I bring that level of complex decision making? And along with that, how do you allow these algorithms then to start discovering patterns which are not visible, not so easily understandable? And attribute, even I'll come to that one. This is an example. So I thought I'll just get a couple of examples that we as JDA have done. We have been working on this in this field of cognitive demand planning with a lot of our customers, and still building it. I mean, it's, we have products which we can go out with and continuously evolving that based on what we see as part of our experience. So this is one example of supervised learning. We have the one number conversation that we were having, right? So how do I move from a point forecast to a distribution-driven forecast? Can I come back and say that my forecast for this time period is not 55.72, but that's the most probable number, but I actually have some kind of a distribution? How do I come up with that kind of a distribution? And that may not be a normal distribution. It may be a very different kind. We might not even be able to classify that distribution. How do I do that? How do I take that? And then the next step would be, how do I drive my supply planning? How do I bring that information back? As we spoke about in the morning, that agility in the supply chain. So this could serve as a good guidance. It can tell me what are the extremes and what kind of probabilities am I looking at, so that while agility is important, that's what I want to focus on, at the same time, if I can optimize the cost while keeping that agility in mind, yeah, these kind of distributions can help us. The other is the whole, in the supervised learning that we have been doing with some of our retailers, is around attribute-based forecasting. What that means is, say, when you and I as consumers go into a retail shop, or when we want to buy, say, garments, right, we are usually thinking about attributes. That we usually don't have a specific SKU in mind, saying that this is the specific design, this is the specific color, and the shape of the sleeves and the neck and everything. We usually base our buying also around attributes. You would go, okay, I want to buy maybe a product from this brand, or this kind of a color. I want either maybe a black and white, or maybe a pastels, or I have some kind of an attribute that I'm looking for, or whether it's round neck or three-fourth sleeves. And so what this does is that these algorithms, they look into the history, they look into the past. So I'm not, when I'm forecasting in the future, I'm not really saying this is the SKU that I have sold so many units in the last few weeks or months, and this is what I will sell. But I'm actually extracting what are the attributes that have sold. And I'm really talking about forecasting the attributes. I'm saying that these attributes are transferable. I mean, the demand is transferable across these attributes. So what it means is that if I'm able to extract that black and white t-shirts are selling more, then I need to be able to forecast that is what is the trend. It is on the color, or it's on the type of a neck. like not on a specific SQL. So these are algorithms where you need to specify what are the attributes you are looking at, because it's a supervised learning approach. So you need to give a lot of inputs there. But the algorithms then pick it up and say, how do I then use that in my future forecasting? And then at the end of the day, I still need to know which is the actual SKU that I need to sort and produce. The other piece, I mean, this kind of puts down all the specific inputs that we are looking at, that we have been looking at in the past with our engagements. Sales definitely is part of a traditional forecasting approach. What have I historically sold? This is a new acronym that we have been hearing and which we have been using called SNEW, which is kind of a mix and match on the news. So that's social, news, events, and weather. So SNEW data is what everyone's talking about these days. Like, how do I bring this new information into my forecasting? And the others, definitely market forces. I may even have sensors. I might be having sensors sitting in my sale point. But earlier, we used to have a point of sale information that's flowing into our systems, but that would typically be at the end of the day, or at the end of a week or month, whatever our cycle was. What these sensors can help us enable is, as and when products are actually pulled out from the shelf or pulled out from the shop, they can pretty much in real time pass on that information. Now, do I want to use that information in real time is the second conversation. And that this is what, in terms of the second slide that we were talking about, what has changed. We at least have access to that data. Now, does it really make sense to use that data is part of the joint engagement, right, on the consulting side of and validation part, I would say that. Does it really make sense? Does this data even help me improve the forecast or not, or is it just an overload? What the algorithms would do is, in the unsupervised piece, is the question I also usually get asked is that, how is it different? If I look at regression models, they are also a type of learning algorithm. And that's also, I'm trying to identify which are my most influencing variables, right? The influencing variables, and hence I built some kind of a regression model on top of that. One of the pieces, the key difference that this also brings in is the that you as a planner, you don't really need to say these are the relevant attributes or these are the relevant variables that need to be used. You can just put in whatever information you have. The machine learning part comes in there, where it says that which of these attributes or data points are relevant for which part of the SKUs or which portion of my business. So there may be certain products which I have where a social news or social sentiment may be a driving factor. Maybe there are other products where it is not a driving factor. So the machine learning part actually, or the cognitive aspect, the learning aspect comes in there, where it tries to figure out and it tries to test, the algorithms try to test themselves to say whether this really is an influencing variable or not. These are some, again, some sample studies that we have been doing with our customers. There is a toy manufacturer. So they wanted to leverage social media feeds, social sentiment analysis, because this was they had a case where they got to know of stockouts happening in their stores through Twitter. So that's when they got to understand the power of social media. They had no idea that they had recently launched a new product and that was going out of stock at most of the stores. So when they got to know this through Twitter, they realized that yes, this is really, it makes sense for us to bring that feedback into my planning or my demand and supply. We had a CPG manufacturer where they wanted to look at external signals and automating processes. So that was the other use case there. In the fashion retail, the use case there was more around the attribute that we talked about, the demand transferability, the example earlier. So these are just some sample use cases, just kind of rushing a little bit in the interest of time. Now, how do we do it? Once we know all of that, we understand that there are algorithms that we need to implement. This is an approach that we have found useful, and I'm sure many of us would be doing that. We usually start off with a pilot. We say, let's take a sample business line or business unit within your entire portfolio. Let's make sure, let's validate whatever we are trying to develop. Let's validate our hypothesis, our algorithms on that pilot. Right? And once that is validated, it then becomes part of my regular run. And then I start onboarding additional product lines, maybe in 3 phases, 4 phases, 10 phases, whatever we are comfortable with. And as and when they get onboarded, they become part of my regular automated runs. So that's the kind of approach that we have been using, which we have found it to also work with our customers. The last one, does it really make sense? I mean, is there a benefit case? There were certain reports also that we have been reading in the news where people have, businesses have built cognitive models, but those accuracies have not been better than the traditional approaches. There are instances, and that brings it to the right point there, that the model design is very, very essential, and that has to be really relevant for your part, your business, the business scenario that you are operating in. We cannot really copy a particular model from one customer or one industry and just start using it elsewhere. So if you don't do that, that's where you read those reports where people say, yeah, there was so much of data, we built all these models, but the accuracy was actually worse off than what the traditional models gave. But if you really do it right, there are definitely improvements. And some of us have also shared in the day that we have seen double-digit improvements, double-digit percentage point improvements in accuracies, and definitely translating into business value on the inventory, fill rates, and all those aspects. So that's all I would want to leave you with. And the sensor there is showing me I'm 1 minute over time, so so I'm available here for the rest of the evening. If there are any more questions, we can definitely discuss that.